It's nice, you know. So now this is as expected, signs of the times, signs in the heavens of, the end times, the transition. Humanity on Earth is kept ignorant mainly or significantly by the view that there isn't a whole universe out there. You know, how many people look up at stars at night? Almost nobody, really. You know, if people would just kick back and look at the stars for 10 or 20 minutes, they would start thinking, what's it all about? You know, what a great creation. What an amazing universe. And what's it all about? So, you know, I think we have to get through our frustration. And again, as I've said before, it really is a sacrifice for wanderers to be here. So, you know, there are lots and lots of wrong views that we have assumed in harmony with the prevailing wrong views of this world. And one of them is that, you know, life should be, about pleasure and having a good time. Well, it's nice, but that's not the goal of life or incarnation. So Ra said the purpose of incarnation is evolution of mind, body, spirit. The purpose of incarnation is evolution of mind, body, spirit. So that's why we have challenges. If you wanted a vacation, higher self would have, we would have agreed with higher self to stay upstairs. But we're not here for vacation, and they're not either. So, in many ways, one of the prevailing teachings of the negative forces here in the modern time now is life is about conformity and submission to authority and working for your living and then thoughtless pleasure distraction to take up the slack before you go back to your working. So working for the man and then blowing off steam. A lot of life is like that. But I think at the end of the day, we need to be strong enough to expect very, very little from other people and realize that primarily we have to be our own rock and support. And there are good people who can be with us, and there is real support and help that can be received by those really good people, but they're few and far between. And the majority is unreachable, other than by simple kindness and a few words, and that's it, because they don't want more. And that's okay. So we need to be strong enough to be not needed by those who need us, or not wanted by those who need us, and don't realize what they need in general. They don't really need us, but they do need to wake up. But it's their call. So we have to just make our lives good enough and fulfilling enough without them, without the factor of being in demand by them. And basically walking around as a knower who can say little. To be comfortable as a knower, as one who knows, also knowing that little can be said. And that's fine. We can radiate love light or love care. And that's enough. Or love understanding. We can accept them as they are. We can understand why they are that way, how they are that way, how it's similar to us, for sure. How it's not similar. So, but it's a big thing, because we come here for them in a way, and then they don't want us. But actually, we don't come here for them. We really come here for us and for the Logos, to help the Logos through it, to simply provide love light to the Creator working through this system. And it's very much in harmony with what we want for ourselves and our group. So I think, it's a certain strengthening that's required to make peace with all that. Or making peace with it is a self-strengthening. But it's basically love wisdom again. Accepting what is, understanding it better, and working through our own reactions, right? Of which there are many. Making peace with all that too. Our reactions to what can't be changed outside ourselves. So, I think wisely decreasing expectations is important. Decreasing expectations of others in accord with what they are. We shouldn't expect, it's like I've said, you can't expect ants to talk. Ants don't talk. So if you stand in front of an ant talking, waiting for a verbal reply, you're going to wait a long time, and it's kind of foolish. And in this application, it means that people who really don't want to go there won't go there, and we're wrong to try to bring them there. And they'd rather suffer in ignorance than move through the challenge of seeing these truths. So be it. We have other work, And that's actually another point, is what is your greater work, or what is the work that's really, really fulfilling? I mean, you shouldn't be wasting time in unfulfilling work, right? Service to others that's really unfulfilling because it's not much desired. We shouldn't be, attached to the futile. So, take care of yourself, do what you want. But it's not good to depend on the seeking of others who don't seek. It's a very great challenge to know people well. In some ways, the mark of how well we know ourselves, the measure of how well we know ourselves, is how clearly and quickly and well we know others. If we're consistently confused about others, it's because we're consistently unclear about ourselves. And as we become more aware of what we are, we can know them better. And as we can know them better, we can know ourselves better. So there's a feedback, of course. So I think if we're consistently unclear about others, we have to realize that that's a problem of seeing. We're not seeing. There are obscurations or blockages or veils in the line of sight, in our line of sight between, the mind and the other self. So those are our own blockages that need to be dissolved and healed and released and all that, so we can see clearly. And usually there's just a long, long interaction between experiencing with others and being confused and getting some trouble, and then slowly seeing more clearly and making new choices and having less suffering and seeing better and being more at peace inside and out with others too. I think people just, you need to have sharp, you need a sharp sword
you should carry a sharp sword of wisdom and cut through the lies. You have to make a distinction between what you want and what is. You want what you want. We want what we want. Fine, no problem. And we should be very clear what I want. And then we should be very clear what is. What is this in front of me? I don't assume it is what I want. I assume I don't know. I assume I don't know what it is. Because I'm humble and clear enough to know I don't know. I know very, very, very little. We all do, actually. So, starting from assumed not understanding or limited knowing, we seek greater knowing. Okay, let me look into it. But I'm not going to distort what it is based on what I want it to be. I want to see what it really is itself, separate from what I want and how I feel. I don't care how I feel, in a way, because I simply want to know what it is. Who is this person? Positive, negative, high, low, clear, confused? What's your game, man? What's the plan? Where is this guy going with his words? So, you know, there's non-polarized, which is most people we meet. In some ways they're good, in some ways they're selfish, in most ways they don't seek, and they don't have a lot to offer. They're nice, maybe. You can be nice to them and help them, that's nice. Maybe they appreciate, that's great. But in general, they're not positive. They're not negative, but they're not really on the positive path. They're just living the life, which is most people. But they don't want much truth. Then there are those who know more and think more. Most of what they think is wrong. Most of what they've been taught are lies. Right? Church, state, media, family, education, most of it is lies or small view. Some of it is principle, or some of it is truth and valuable, but most of it is lie. Now, what do they want? Well, they're probably involved in supporting something, the more intelligent, thoughtful people. What they're usually supporting are other lies. But some of them have a good heart, too. And then you have the people who are presenting themselves as speakers of truth, or teachers, or researchers, or leaders. And then you're generally going to have clearly positive or negative. And then you're going to have clear positive with some confusion and humility, or clear positive with a lot of confusion, but they're clearly positive, or you have clear negative and they're liars, and you have to be careful. So, you know, there's a difference between mind and heart. There's a difference between positive with humility and positive with arrogance. And then there's a difference between high-level negative and low-level negative. So all of that is discernible when you contact a person or a source of information. And that's what we want. That's the lonely work of wisdom, which is to discern, you know, where what's coming at me here. And, you know, when you find something, when I find something that's high and clear and unified like Ra, or some Buddhism, or Taoism, or, you know, Hilarion source, or some other mystic source, then I want to stay with it. So just be careful. You know, look into what you're putting your mind to. And definitely people are losing it these days. Yeah, you know, I mean, really, honestly, any teacher that wants to be a leader, I don't trust. Any teacher, any person who claims to be spiritually developed and wants to lead others, I don't trust. Anybody who really announces that they have a spiritual level or that they are a spiritual leader, I don't trust. Now, if the guy is, you know, just a good student of his teacher and succeeds the teacher, like in Buddhism or Hinduism or Taoism or something, but that's different. Then they just assume a position in an organization which is the result of them being good students, not being, you know, eager to control, then maybe that's okay. I mean, it all depends on the person. But in general, the really high-level teachers don't need followers, don't need an ashram, don't need anybody. They don't care. If you come, they help. If you don't come, they don't go get you. So be careful, folks, you know? Follow yourself. But if you think about a higher life, you know, what if all of your desires were fulfilled now in an instant? Now what? Now what do you do? After that, then what do you do? You know? Because then you have to actually focus on what has more value than getting all the things you want. Yeah, and I think experiencing the process is a deepening into rather than, it's certainly not accumulative or acquisitive. It's accumulative in that it's a progressive or developing. But it's not accumulative because acquisitive, like we're not acquiring things and stuff. There's a line in Tao Te Ching, something like, the man of the world every day gains more and more, but the man of the Tao every day lets go of more and more, or finds he has less and less. You know, in the sense of complexity, or desires, or frustration, or conflict. You know, it's like satisfaction with what you have, you know, or joy, partially, is total fulfillment with what is, which means, at that time, complete loss of desire for what is not. For anything other than what is right here now. Yeah. So then life is a series of snapshots. That distinction actually is also recognized in deeper meditation, where, you know, that, and that's similar to the higher self being outside of change. It's not like this changes to that, but this appears and that appears, and each one has its own wholeness, and in a certain way stands independent, or each event, each situation. And you see, because if you say it's not moving, then it isn't changing. But clearly this, you know, this moment and the next moment are not identical, right? I think the idea is that there isn't this moment and next moment. There's just this moment. There's this moment and this moment and this moment, and each one is different.
but they're not actually moving from one to another. Yeah, well, it's very, you know, the image of or the analogy of a movie projector is extremely useful metaphysically. So there's the screen, there's the images on the screen, there are sounds, then there's the transmission of light through the darkness that gives rise to the images on the screen. And then there's the projector. And then the projector basically shows, you know, a miniature or digitized miniature version of what appears on the screen. And then, you know, traditionally there's a projector of light, a light source projector. Well, the light source projector is higher self, or you can say the light source projector is actually the light of pure awareness. What is awareness, right? I mean, you're aware of my words. I'm aware of my words and sitting in a chair. What is this awareness? Yeah, there is attachments. There are attachments to awareness, and there's comprehension of awareness. There are consequences of awareness. But what is awareness, pure and simple, itself? I'm aware of the sensations of sitting in my chair. That I'm I, whatever that is basically conscious of sensations that I identify as sitting in this chair, my body sitting in the chair, in the room. So, but all of that labeling is labeling atop awareness. So, but the awareness in and of itself, what is it? You can't say. You can't say. We don't know. Because that's at a higher level than consciousness. Awareness is higher than consciousness. Awareness is basically life. So, it seems to me, the electricity that runs the projector that shifts or sends the image from the digitized miniature form out onto the screen of life, the electricity that runs that projector is of course the light of the octave, you know, vibratory condition, or it's the pure sentient awareness light of the creator. The light, creator light, which is seven density octave light, that is aware. That's what runs the projector. But then within the projector, or within the smaller experience, you have basically an observer and the means of appearance and appearance. Appearance is on the screen, that's the what we see in front of us, which is really our definitions of it. What you see is really what you're defining. Mm-hmm. And just because we all have this similar 3D body, we have similar 3D senses, we have similar 3D sensational or sensory perceptions, right? We can all see red versus orange versus white because our eyes are similar. But what one person thinks of the bottle that's red and the bottle that's orange is subjective or not collective. So everybody makes their own. But actually, the red I see is different than the red you see. That's also very subtle. I can say, oh yeah, the bottle is red. I'm looking at some containers and I'm saying, the container is red. But when you say that, yeah, it's red. The red you see is not the same as what I see. It's close, but it's not the same because it's done by you. In fact, you can't even describe it. But it would be associated with your past experiences of something similar. But the projector, you know, is us making experience. And it's very much done by frame by frame. Bonk, 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 bonk. So there is no change, or there is no movement, but there's a sequence of static images in sequence, right? Or there's a series of static images in progression that gives rise to the appearance of motion. This is actually very high philosophy, and it fits very well high states of meditation, where there can be the experience of no change or no movement. I have very vividly had the experience, and never forget it, of after a long one-week Zen meditation retreat, coming down the mountain with the monks in the van in upstate New York, and looking and seeing that the mountain, as we were driving down the mountain road, that nothing was moving, or I was not moving. It was just coming through me. I was not moving through the landscape. The landscape was moving through me. It was very dramatic. Yeah, it was really noteworthy, because I really saw the unmoving self perceiver, the unmoving perceiver that is simply watching phenomena come through me. I'm not going anywhere. And it's really impossible to get that experience back, because it's a reversal. Now, it's actually not the summit of experience of that, because it's simply a reversal of the normal, the common distortion that I'm moving through a static landscape. But actually, I'm the projector, and I am the light source projecting through the miniature, the digitized blueprint, which is the etheric, of course. So I am the projector through the digitized or the analogous etheric blueprint of my life onto then experiencing the result of that transmission of myself through some kind of a template onto the screen of physical 3D reality. That's actually a lot closer than what we normally think. So you know, that's the value of deep meditation, is that you can actually live these, you know, far out philosophical speculations. It's very true. These things are very true, and that's, you know, that's the line that the mystic swims in, the waters, in the same waters in which the psychotic, the crazy man drowns. They're really the waters of multidimensionality, formlessness, unity, no self, infinity, energy over solidity, you know, insubstantiality. So it's good. It's good to be able to see that, you know, our normal experience of life is really quite distorted. But the more we can get a sense of what we are, the more we can see this life more straight rather than upside down. Anyway, there's some passage on that in Buddhism. Maybe we can? In the Pali Canon. Some very, very esoteric collection of suttas here that I had not found before. I never heard of it. And I'll give you the link here. It's called the Parayana Vaga. Vaga, I guess, means verse. Okay, good. I'm glad you like that.
Parayana Vaga. It's a sutta. It's number 5 on this page. And there's some very serious talking here. This Parayana Vaga. Let's go into this a little bit. There's another link that shows the description of it. And that's the second one there. Parayana Vaga HTML. This was a conversation. This was recorded conversations between 16 Brahmin ascetics who were students of another teacher who questioned Shakyamuni, the Gautama Buddha, about the essence of his teaching. Many of them were adepts. All of them were adepts. They were all adepts, actually. And the tradition says that 15 of the 16 attained complete and perfect enlightenment immediately after hearing the Buddha's responses. Now, that may be true, it may not be true. And the 16th questioner achieved stream entry or one of the levels of enlightenment. So all 16 of them had breakthrough after hearing the Buddha's talk. All 16 of them were very advanced. And I never heard of such a thing. In the writing commentary he gives, says, there's evidence that these 16 dialogues were highly regarded right from the very early centuries of Buddhist tradition as concise statements of profound teachings, particular to Buddhism. They sparked an attitude of devotion, coupled with desire to understand their more cryptic passages. There are many. There's even a discussion later in another sutra commentary saying that there was a lay woman, a woman Buddhist practitioner, who made a practice of rising before dawn to chant the full set of 16 dialogues. Very interesting. This is a real deal. Old teaching by dialogue, by real questions. Let me read one of these dialogues, and it pertains, that's the link there, it's Upasiva Manava Pucha, Upasiva's questions. Upasiva Manava Pucha. And tell me when you're there and we can read it together. Okay, so it starts with Upasiva. Again, he's a Brahmin ascetic, one of these 16 fellows who questioned Buddha. So he says, alone, Sakyan. Sakyan means that the Buddha is from the Shakya clan. So Shakyamuni, as the term for the Buddha, Gautama Buddha. Shakya is the name of his tribe, his clan, his group in northern India. Shakyan means one of the Shakya group. Shakyamuni means the sage or enlightened one of the Shakya group, the Shakya Muni. Muni, M-U-N-I, relates to sage or seer. So alone, he's talking to the Buddha. Alone, Shakyan, and with nothing to rely on, I can't venture across the great flood, meaning the suffering in his mind. Tell me, and this was the term for the Buddha, all-around eye, not all-seeing eye, but something like that, all-around eye, that's the term they used for the one term they used for the Buddha. Tell me, all-around eye, the support to rely on for crossing over this flood, the flood of birth and death, or the flood of desire, attachment, ignorance. And the Buddha responds, mindfully focused on nothingness, relying on there isn't, you should cross over the flood. Abandoning sensual pleasures, abstaining from conversations, keeping watch for the ending of craving, night and day. I repeat it again. Mindfully focused on nothingness, relying on there is not, you should cross over the flood. Abandoning sensual pleasures, abstaining from conversations, keep watch for the ending of craving, night and day. Upasiva replies, one free from passion for all sensual pleasures, relying on nothingness, letting go of all else, released in the highest emancipation of perception. Does he stay there unaffected? Very good question. Meaning, the person who's free from passion, free from desire for sensual pleasure, which is grasping, relying on nothingness, not depending on view or thinking or thought, letting go of all else, letting go of all seeking of anything, released in the highest emancipation of perception, emancipation of perception, very deep statement or phrase. Does he stay there unaffected? The Buddha, who knows what he's talking about, answers, one free from passion for all sensual pleasures, relying on nothingness, letting go of all else, released in the highest emancipation of perception, he stays there unaffected. Okay. So that's nibbana. That's the emancipation or release. Then Upasiva, who's smart, knows that there's more to question about this. And he says, if he stays there, because Upasiva probably knows this state a little bit, if he stays there, oh, all around I, unaffected for many years, right there, would he be cooled and released? Would his consciousness be like that? And the Buddha tries to explain in more detail, because there are certain misunderstandings in Upasiva's question that have to be untangled, actually, to just answer it. The Buddha answers, as a flame overthrown by the force of the wind goes to an end that cannot be classified, so the sage, free from naming activity, goes to an end that cannot be classified. And so that undercuts Upasiva's reification or belief that some of his concepts are real. Like the concept of staying there, I'm now staying in the cooled state forever. That belief is resting on the assumption that those concepts are real, that there's a real me resting in a real permanent state, aware and able to say, I'm me here resting in the cooled state forever. All of that is ignorance and not perception of reality. To believe those things are real or could be that way shows what's called reification, or taking a concept to be real. So again, the Buddha's answer is, as a flame overthrown by the force of wind goes to an end that cannot be classified, so the sage, free from naming activity, goes to an end that cannot be classified. And that's approaching the discussion of nothingness. Like the Buddha said before, relying on nothingness, letting go of all else. Relying on there isn't, there is not. This is very subtle. And so finally, Upasiva, who again is a very developed fellow, asks further, because he already knows that there's certain things unclear. At least for him, some things are unclear. He's smart enough to identify what's unclear to himself. Most people cannot identify what's unclear to them, therefore they can't ask questions, therefore we don't learn. Uh-huh. So, Upasiva replies again, okay, so the Buddha just said, the sage free from naming activity, nama-rupa, putting on names to things, that is reification. The sage free from naming activity, this is a deep level of distortion, right? It's not just I have my desire for sensual pleasure, but I'm naming my perceptions. That obscures the reality of what things are, right? Ross said you're dancing thoughts. But this naming activity is what makes us think everything is real and solid. And the Buddha, Ross counters that and says you're not living in a material universe. You are dancing thoughts. We think we're living in a material universe because of the naming activity. Namarupa. Name and form. Perception of form as the catalyst for us applying naming. That naming is conceptualizing life, making life concept. I don't see you, I see my thoughts of you. I'm not in relation to the creation of love light. I'm in relation to my thoughts about it. But the enlightened one is free from naming activity and thus goes to an end that cannot be classified because there's no more naming. We can try to name it, but that's not its his experience. Thus, Upasiva says, he who has reached the end, does he not exist? Or is he, for eternity, free from dis-ease? Great questions. Please, sage, declare this to me, as this phenomenon has been known by you. The question again, he who's reached the end, does he not exist? Or is he for eternity free from dis-ease? The Buddha, with his Buddha mind, nails it, of course. He's finished with the path, so he can look back on it. The Buddha says, one who has reached the end has no criterion by which anyone would say that. For him, it doesn't exist. When all phenomena are done away with, all means of speaking are done away with as well. So, we can speak, and anyone can speak, but the one who's reached the end, he himself has no criterion or basis by which anyone could explain his condition. We can say anything we want, but the one who's reached the end himself actually couldn't classify his condition because our words don't apply. The naming phenomenon, the naming activity has ceased. Sage is free from naming activity, goes to an end that cannot be classified. For that one who's reached the end, they also have no criterion. So you see, they have no criterion, or they, the gloss on the word criterion actually is explained in another book called The Mind Like Fire Unbound. We could read this sometime. I read it. It's a great book. I have it here, I think. Great book. Free, of course. These guys are real sages. So, the one who's reached the end, he himself, because there's no more naming activity, has no criterion or basis for their experience. There's no criterion in their mind because there's no more naming activity. There's also likewise no name form basis for their condition or their state or their being in release that anyone else could say or talk about. For him, for that one who's reached the end, there is no criterion by which they or anyone else can explain or identify, define their achievement. One who's reached the end has no criterion by which anyone would say that, to say that they'll live forever, to say that they don't exist, or to say that for eternity I'll be free from disease. That's the point. One who's reached the end has no criterion by which anyone could say he exists or he doesn't exist, he exists, he no longer exists, or he's free from disease, existing for all eternity. Right? These are the two choices. He goes into non-existence, or he keeps eternal existence free from disease, dis-ease. Neither of these categories or classifications apply. There's no criterion by which anyone would say that, or nor by which anyone could truly say that, that he doesn't exist or he's free from disease for all eternity. And for him, those criteria don't exist. And here's the point. When all phenomena are done away with, all means of speaking and classifying and naming and defining are done away with as well. And that's the completion of the path. And that's freedom from becoming. Freedom from becoming means there's no more perception of naming. The naming, the engine of naming, meaning using mind to define reality, has ceased, is removed. The engine is broken up. The engine of the thirst for becoming, right? There's the thirst for becoming and the thirst for non-becoming. The thirst for becoming is sensual pleasures and views. the attachment to sensual pleasure or desire, I want a husband, I want a wife, I want a boyfriend, I want a girlfriend, I want a high grade, I want money, I want a house, I want a, you know, I want to eat organic honey. Whatever. These are all desires associated with becoming. I want to be smart. I want you to think I'm smart. I want to achieve. I want success. I want to help people. I want people to be helped. I want to have, you know, some kind of social position. I want to be needed. I want to be involved. I want to be engaged. I want to be here. I don't want to be here. Well, mainly I want to be here. That's all desire for becoming. And in it's associated with material change and ideational change, meaning change in mind, change of idea, right? If you say, Scott, you're great, I have the thought, oh, I'm happy. So if I'm wishing you to say Scott is great, then I'm wishing to have the change of mind towards I am happy that you said I'm great. That's a seeking, that thirst for becoming. It's not quite a sensual pleasure, but it's a thirst for a changed state of mind. Then there's the desire for non-becoming, the desire, there's the thirst for becoming, and then there's the desire for non-becoming. Non-becoming is, I just want peace, just nothingness, no thought, no sensation, no body, just forever bliss, or forever nothingness. I want nothingness. Nothingness is not nothingness. Or enlightenment is not our view of nothing. It's a nothing that's a something. Or it's a reality that can't be classed in words. But the desire to eliminate that which we don't want, or to move into what we consider to be a nothingness in our limited view, that's the desire for non-becoming. So the desire for becoming, or the thirst for becoming, changes of body and mind and feeling, that's one type of attachment or set of desires. The other is the desire for non-becoming. And that's to basically achieve or have the freedom from all the stuff that we imagine to be real, and placement into some kind of imagined void. Okay? So, but you cannot say that the enlightened person does no longer exist, and you cannot say that that one is forever in eternity free of disease. You can't say either. When all phenomena are done away with, or the freedom from naming activity, then all means of speaking or classification are gone too. And that's really heavy stuff. And I think it's very important. And it's related to the Buddhist practice of the Hindu practice of neti neti, or nothing nothing, which I was looking for it here. I didn't find it, but it's one of these, in one of these dialogues, the Buddha basically is talking about the value of depending on the phrase, it is nothing. It is nothing. It isn't. Like what we just said before, it isn't. Is to cut away the attachment to naming activity. So again, we're talking at a much higher level. This is above healing and balance. This is beyond healing and balance. This is the advanced adept work of perceiving the emptiness of consciousness. Okay. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, unity consciousness is non-separation. And in the true understanding, the reason, you see, Buddhism and the Buddha didn't talk about unity. But if we understand what unity really is, it's okay. You know, unity consciousness, to be true awareness of unity, is actually no longer identified as unity consciousness or an experience of unity. To say I am one is not an experience of unity, is not the awareness of unity. Because awareness of unity doesn't include an I. It doesn't say I am unity, I am all. You see, if you make the distinction of I and all, then you're not talking about unity. To say I am one is not the same as to say all is one. The true unity consciousness is all is one, not I am one. All is one assumes or presumes that one is the I. So the all is the I. Therefore, we don't make an equivalence of I am all, but all is one. So that state, that perception that all is one, that's a perception. It's just a perception. That perception, you see, this is very, now we really get deep, because what's real? Well, is a perception real? Yeah, you can say it's real, but it's just a perception. Is it, you know, for us to think what's real, or for us to define real, it's not subjective. It's objective for all. Well, the naming activity is certainly more associated with the left-hand path. Well, Ra once said directly that the naming activity is used as a means of control. That if you want to control somebody, it's better to name them. And you can be aware then in your conversation and relationships with people, if people start using your name a lot, it's probably because they want to control you. So whenever somebody says, yes, Scott, uh-huh, Scott, then I know, what's up with you? What you trying to play on me? So, well, there's a difference between naming. You see, these are all gradations, right? If I say, you know, and use your name many times, surely that's related to desire to control, because it encourages you to identify with your name. It pigeonholes the other by continual naming, which is it's a referencing to your limited identity. It's referencing back. It's a continued referencing to a limited false identity, which is your name. You are not a name. You are what you are. But to continue to reference the person's name, which is an example of referentiality, as you said, is the essence of the naming activity, is very much used on the negative path, is not necessarily negative, but it shows how ignorance and illusion is akin to negative path. You see? This is the connection between the unpolarized and the negative on Earth, which is that ignorance, dogged ignorance, which is non-polarizing, is in some way surely resonant with the negative path. It's certainly a non-rejection of negativity, and a non-rejection in the sense of saying that's not my path. The non-rejection of negativity is akin to the negative path. Because it allows service to self patterns to continue. So the people who are non-polarized are a little good and a little bad, a little positive, a little negative. They're not really rejecting selfishness or you know, greed, service to self, as an option. They're not really rejecting that. Positive path can accept it as it is, but chooses to reject that way. Says, I don't want to go that way. But those who are unpolarized don't really reject it. And that's part of their linkage to the negative. But the naming activity, and so the naming activity can be used by the negatives, or used by people who want to control, for sure. But per se, it's more of ignorance than negative path in the way the Buddha is talking of it here. Yes, and that's the process by which people who continually use a person's name in a conversation are trying to bind them. They're binding the person's sense of self to their name. And they're binding the person's mental process to the referencing of their name. Your mind is being pointed towards your name. That direction of your attention is a minimization or an occulting, right? Occult. It's a dimming, a limiting of your natural spacious awareness. Continuing to be referred to your false identity of your name. It's reducing all you are to the name of your personality, right? And the negatives do that all the time. Even the way that Windows and many companies are naming their products with the word my. It's on the old Windows 95 or before, it was called computer. Now it's my computer, my documents, my file, my space, right? All this I, me, my in the languaging, in technology, my iPad or my, you know, there are a lot of things that are called my something. And, you know, the term on the icons on the desktop, they were in the beginning not called my computer, my documents, my network places. It was just called computer or documents or network places. I remember that. I remember when they started coming out with the word my. That's all the same kind of minimization of consciousness and establishing false identity and divide and conquer. Yeah, it's not, I don't think it's a material, it's limiting awareness, limiting attention or tagging or tying attention and identity to some limited sense of a separate personality. It's a divide and conquer. You know, this is my documents, this is my space, my, me. All of that is a contraction of awareness. And that contraction of awareness is a separative influence dividing people. And then dividing each person within himself. So that kind of divisiveness is the way negatives do control. But the naming principle that the Buddha is talking about, although it's the base, the naming principle or the naming activity is the basis of false identity or egotism or walking around with I, me, my, sure. But the naming activity goes all the way up to higher self. It's the fundamental reification or making reality a concept map. You know, we're interacting with our concepts, not with reality. And that's key to Buddhist awakening or enlightenment, which is to realize that all of our identifications are wrong. You are not your body. You are not your mind. You are not your spirit. You are not even your higher self or the higher self. You are not even love light. You are the source of love light. The source of higher self, the source of body, mind, spirit, the source of sense of personality or ego. The source of all that is our identity. And that's ineffable, infinite, pre-love light, before the establishment of love light. The source of the will that created love light is our true being. Nothing less. Everything else is a vehicle. And every other vehicle is a temporary form, a temporary arrangement of love light. Love is consciousness, light is matter, energy. Right? Energy, matter, energy is light. Consciousness, awareness is love. The source of that is the will that be, that there be, let there be light, let there be love, light. That's the one infinite creator, that's the logos. That's infinity. So our source, the source of all conjecture, the source of all misidentification is our essence or infinity. Infinite intelligence, intelligent infinity, as Ra said. That is the ineffable, and that is to know that, to be that, is a cessation of naming activity, complete blowing out of the flame of false identity, false identification, experience, you know, the assumed reality of an experience of duality. Assuming our experience or perception of duality is reality. our experience of duality being really simply our perceptions of duality. That is then countered by a perception of oneness, in which there's the realization all is one. That's the infinity of consciousness. Beyond that is the infinity of nothingness, which is achieved by neti neti, or by realizing it isn't. It isn't. There isn't. There isn't. That's, there is nothing. There's somewhere in one of these suttas the Buddha says we rely on there is nothing. That in the state of the infinity of consciousness or unity, one applies the recognition there is nothing. So meditation is not just sitting there and letting things happen. And that's a large part of it, but that's not the whole thing. The other part is that at a very high level, higher levels of mind, there's the application of the teaching to that momentary experience in the deep meditation, in the jhana, in the trance. So upon perception of the infinity of consciousness, right, all is one, in that the adept brings forth the view there is nothing, and then realizes, this experience of the infinity of consciousness or unity is another reification, or is another naming activity. This is my experience of this blissful oneness is also involved in my naming. It is also part and parcel of naming activity. And to the naming activity, I say there is nothing. Or there is just naming activity. And then the experience of this infinity of consciousness naturally goes to the infinity of nothingness. And that nothingness is not a void, but it's a freedom from naming activity. And that's seventh density. And that's one inch away from complete and perfect enlightenment. Maybe a millimeter. So this is very, very high and subtle, but I'd like to do more of these dialogues at some point, or read more from them, because it's very, very, it's great to hear the Buddha talking to an adept. So, and thank you again. I appreciate everybody being here, and see you all next week. Okay, good night.